Before you watch this video, make sure you check out episode one. We've had the pleasure to collab with Reyes the Entrepreneur, and he hosted the first episode. So make sure you check out that video first. The link is in the description below, or hit the thumbnail, and let's go dive deeper into Onit Coffee. Talk to me about revenue. What's a good day? What's a bad day dollar-wise?
So we did that with about 20 different influencers, and it generated a lot of leads for us and didn't cost us much money at all.
Why don't we dive into franchising a little bit? Do you have plans to franchise it? Tell me how quick it took you to break even.
That would have saved me a lot of time, a lot of money that I spent on payroll out of pocket when we first started, and we would have grown a lot quicker.
That's kind of contrary to what other food truck owners would tell me. You guys, we're here with a CEO, owner, founder of Onit Coffee. What an amazing, unique business that we can't wait to share with you. Shadi, thanks for doing this with us.
Thank you so much, brother.
Let's dive into it. Let's talk about your initial budget, what it costs to get started in your experience.
So I've invested nearly $120,000 into the truck, right? State-of-the-art truck, brand new chassis, La Marzocco coffee bar, brand new equipment, some inventory costs, some costs for, permits, payroll. You want to have kind of that initial, right? That initial investment ready to operate, right, for the first couple of months. So starting off, I would say about $120,000 invested into the project.
Okay, so break the 125 down for us.
So how was it allocated? So a large portion of that was the actual build out of the kitchen. It was honestly the vast majority. So a portion of it was the truck cost itself, the chassis, buying a brand new truck, right? Mm-hmm. And then the other portion was the actual build out of the kitchen, right? Doing the construction, installing everything. And then another smaller portion of that was the actual equipment itself, the coffee bar, the grinder, the fridge, all the other machinery needed.
Let's do a walkthrough of the truck and then the facility and show us what you want to show us and point out.
Absolutely. So before we get into that, just to show you, we have our to-go parking signs right here.
Okay.
One of the creative ideas we came up with, we dedicated three parking spots on the property to to-go parking for curbside pickup, right? Because it's getting a little bit colder outside and the COVID and everything going on, you can park right here, scan the barcode, you'll view the full menu, text or call the number, right? Goes to the truck, to our business phone. They'll get your order, they'll confirm, come out, pay cash, credit, whatever, on Square, and they'll bring your order right to you. Convenience, it's helped us out a lot.
It's very unique.
All righty.
You got a cool looking truck, by the way.
Thank you so much.
A lot to talk about what's on it. Why don't we start with what's on the ground there, and that's really a plethora of options.
So right here we have our hot drinks, right? We just launched a lot of those for the winter season. Some of them are seasonal, right? Mm-hmm. And we have, for example, our Mexican hot chocolates, very popular. Our Moroccan mint tea, our red velvet right now is very, very popular. Our matcha lattes, right? Right here is the build your own menu. So if you would like to build your own drink, we kind of break it down for you with different options. We have a lot of sugar-free options for diabetic folks. We have teas, coffees. We have alternative milk options. A lot of different options, a lot of different toppings for build your own.
You got some food options I see right
here.
Yep,
we have our little
Keeping it simple.
Yep, keeping it simple. Our soy riso burrito, very popular for, the vegan eaters, right? Mm-hmm. And then, of course, you got our Egg Fit muffins. We have our little Nutella crepe sticks.
Tried those this morning. Delicious.
Yep. A lot of different food options. A lot of different food options. We're expanding that menu.
Talk to me about revenue. Maybe when you started and where you are now. What's a good day? What's a bad day dollar-wise?
When we started, it was brutal, to be honest with you. We were making maybe $50 a day.
Ouch.
Right? And we tried moving around in the beginning a little bit, mm-hmm. right? A good day at one point was maybe like $200, right? Which was not good. As we changed our business model and adapted with COVID-19 and kind of turned the truck almost into a location mm-hmm. where people always come find us on a regular basis, we've broken $3,000-$4,000 in a day before, right?
Amazing.
We've averaged between the $1,500 to $2,000 range for the past couple of months. So a good day for us, I would say, is between that $1,500 to $2,000. A remarkable day would be breaking the two, mm-hmm. going upwards of three or more. And a bad day, I'd say, is like under $1,000 right now.
Let's talk about the truck. Beautiful design, impacting lives one cup at a time. And you've got by the city, for the city, to serve the city. I mean, just amazing slogans. Can you share the story behind that?
Absolutely. So the mission with Onit is to work with a different nonprofit every 3 months or so to target causes that Team Onit feels we need to shed more light upon, right? Mm-hmm. Mental health, suicide prevention, sex trafficking, refugees in need. These are causes and issues that we need to talk about, you know? We just wrapped up our campaign in November with My Sister's House, a local nonprofit that's been around for 20 years, and they help victims of sex trafficking in Sacramento. It's a major issue that is not being talked about.
It is.
And we did a simple campaign, 25 cents from every single drink for the month of November went to them, right? And we called the campaign, I am not a number, meaning you're more than a statistic, you're more than a number, you're a human being, mm-hmm. and there's a nonprofit that cares about you. And as a local coffee company, right, we want to give back and do our part to serve the city. And that's really the mission with Onit, man, is to impact lives, serve the city of Sacramento. I want to build the next major coffee franchise in the Sacramento area. My drive-through is opening up hopefully late this summer, and as well as our dine-in location. And the vision for the company is to allow people from within the company to own their own franchise location, right? Mm-hmm. As you work your way up, you know, in the company and become part of management, I'd like to finance a location for you where you pay back the company over time, and now you own your own location. And that's how you build that long-term commitment, and people see the value in working for Onit. I'm like, okay, I'm not just here making minimum wage. I can work my way up to own a 6-7-figure business,
right?
To own my own kiosk or kiosks, right? And that is the vision for the company, and we're taking it one step at a time and trying to do our best to impact lives and serve the city of Sacramento.
Tell me how quick it took you to break even.
I would say to break even, it took us about 6 to 7 months.
6 to 7 months.
Six to 7 months, and honestly, the consistent traffic that we've built up and the reviews and the customers in the seating area has been remarkable. And we've been able to thrive, you know, significantly within 6-7 months.
It's amazing. It was around that time as well when we were pushing media and changing our outlet on Instagram, or the way we did things on Instagram, changing the pictures from just regular pictures to quality and really promoting and doing those things. Everything kind of came together. We started to have crazy engagement. And that's where our days went from, like he was saying earlier in the video, about $50 to anywhere from $1,000 to $2,000.
So you guys never stopped, again, improving on an hourly, minute-by-day basis. That's what I'm hearing, too, which is really encouraging.
We're constantly looking for unique, innovative ways to grow the business, to market ourselves differently. We've done a lot of unique events, man. For example, we did one. It was a gaming tournament where the winner won a PS5. We had 85 gamers. Right, each one did a $20 entry, and we made about $4,000 or $5,000 that day, and it was a fun time. We did another one, comedy night with local comedian Lance Woods. We set up a stage. He came out and performed. 250 people came out. We've done car meets, cars and coffee. Had a couple hundred people show up to that. Just unique things, because when you do these events, what happens is you attract different crowds. With the car meets, you're attracting that car crowd. With the gaming tournament, you're attracting kind of the gaming crowd, right? Now you're introducing all these different crowds to Onit Coffee that maybe would never have came to Onit or thought about it. But because you did an event tailored to their industry, their crowd, their interest, they support Onit Coffee. They want to get involved. Mm-hmm. So what I'm trying to do is kind of get Onit involved in so many different things to really diversify the crowds that come here. Let's get you a little drink.
Let's try the Mexican hot chocolate.
Let's do that.
I've never heard of that before.
The old Mexican, huh? Got you, brother.
So I ready for you, boss?
What is this again?
It's a Mexican hot chocolate, by the way.
Mexican hot chocolate.
This is one of the go-tos, the signatures.
Ooh.
It's a delight, huh?
That's unique.
Thank you.
Not too sweet, and it's got that right
chocolatey taste.
Oh, yeah, I like it.
There you go.
All right, so you've got a beautiful concept here, amazing mission. Why don't we dive into franchising a little bit? Do you have plans to franchise it? Who's working on that? What does the plan look like, cost-wise, too?
Yeah, I do have plans to franchise. My main goal right now is open up the first drive-thru, right, this summer. Open up the dine-in location, close on the second drive-thru. And then I want to see kind of numbers, how we're doing, assess everything. maybe take like a year or two to really kind of make sure our infrastructure is there, the process is there.
Right.
Then I'm going to really look into the next steps to franchise, right? I haven't really put together like a solid plan in terms of what are the numbers to franchise and how we're going to do all that.
Okay.
Because right now, my main concern is opening up the first drive-thru, right? That is the main thing I want to focus on. Once we accomplish that goal, hopefully this summer, from there, the next goal will be, okay, let's build the structure and the plan for franchising. What's the cost? How much is it going to be?
Mm-hmm.
All those things.
Okay. Let's talk about the most successful form of advertising.
Advertising, by far, I would say Instagram has been our biggest platform to advertise on. And we do a lot, we run a lot of ads on Instagram. We boost a lot of posts, and that's how we've reached 700,000 impressions at one point. We also run ads on Yelp. So we really try to target kind of the social media, right? The social media and, you know, Google, Yelp.
Yeah, if you both want to touch on that. Yeah.
Back when we were moving the truck around itself, and that wasn't as successful as keeping it in one location, we decided that our delivery services, Grubhub, DoorDash, Uber Eats, and there's one more.
Postmates.
We're going to be our key to success, especially with coronavirus entering and all these different changes. So what we did is we did different deals with DoorDash, all these different services like 20% off with an order of $15 and above, and different advertisements with the delivery services as well as Instagram and Yelp. And we're advertising through Google and Facebook ads. That way we get more leads. And what we do is we call the customers and personally invite them down and create that bond with each and every one as we can.
We've also done the more traditional route too of flyers. On the flyer, it said like you could redeem buy one, get one free if you bring this flyer in, right? To track the effectiveness of the flyers. And we went out home to home and delivered within like a 5-mile radius. And that actually worked. We had a lot of people come in and, you know, present their flyer. And that really worked out for us. We did another thing too. So we selected a couple different people with pretty good engagement on Instagram that believed in the vision in the company. And they came down and shot a picture with their favorite drink. And they did a giveaway, right? So, you know, comment on this pic, tag your friends, whatever. We're going to pick one person. They're going to win 3 free drinks to Onit Coffee, right? So we did that with about 20 different influencers, if you want to call them that, in the Sacramento area.
Right.
And it generated a lot of leads for us and didn't cost us much money at all.
You've got an amazing amount of reviews, and you've been in it for just under a year,
about eight months.
How did you get so many reviews so quickly?
It involves a couple of different things, right? One of the main things is I partnered up with Yelp Sacramento, and I did a couple elite weeks, right? Elite week where they bring down different elite members to try out your drinks, your services, right? So these elite members, they came down, tried our drinks, and left us reviews based on their experience, right? In addition to that, as we became a stationary location, we started to serve upwards of 2,000 or 3,000 people a week. When you're seeing 2,000 or 3,000 people a week, there's going to be a percentage that drops a review. And we would ask our customers, as a local business, right, as a minority-owned small business, if you could please leave us a review during this difficult time, it would mean the world to us, right?
Yeah.
And so we grew to 200-plus reviews on Yelp and nearly 200 on Google within 8 months. You know, and now if you search up coffee in Elk Grove, we pop up in the top 5 as a coffee truck.
Right.
There are coffee shops that have been around for 4 or 5 years in Elk Grove, Sacramento, that don't even have 200 reviews. You know, so it's been pretty remarkable, man.
We hear Yelp all the time. What was the cost for you to get involved with Yelp, with the elite members?
So they cover, to be honest with you, they cover a portion of the elite week, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you can negotiate with them and come to an agreement. But you're going to have to sacrifice something. You know what I mean? So for us, it was a couple $100s, nothing really
not too significant.
Right? They covered a portion of it. But I think the return on investment is huge. You know, I feel it's worth it.
We got some blitz questions for you. Don't think too much. 10 seconds, otherwise it's a penalty.
It's
a hefty one.
Woo!
All right. So what's one sentence you'd like to hear from your employees?
We love working at Onit.
What's the best and worst part of being an entrepreneur?
Best part is impacting lives,
okay.
Manifesting your vision. Worst part, all the stress that comes with it.
Absolutely, can't avoid that. Biggest purchase you regret?
Probably some of the cars that I've purchased. Unnecessary.
Name one.
X5M.
Okay. What business book had the biggest impact on you and why?
How to Win Friends and Influence People.
Well, I have that.
Beautiful. And why? It really talks to you about how to talk to people and, you know what I mean, and kind of get to know them and have them open up to you.
That's important.
Big one.
If you had to come up with a slogan for year 2020, what would it be?
Spread love.
Spread love. That's good. What's one thing that you'd like to see disappear from planet Earth?
Arrogance, ego, and hatred. Not one thing, three.
Awesome. How did you come up with the logo? Just quick.
So the logo, man, even the name, I was looking at different franchises and different companies, and I was looking at In-N-Out, right? In-N-Out, very simple, very catchy. You're in, you're out, you get your food, you leave, you know? And you don't forget it, In-N-Out. And I was like, on it. The word on it kept coming to me like, I'm on it. We always say like, okay, I'm on it, right? And then I'm like, man, your coffee needs, we're on it. Like, we're on top of it, right? And then when people go, let's go get on it, it sounds like they're saying, let's get on it. You know what I mean? Not like, let's
very,
get.
Very,
it's very catchy.
Very catchy.
The logo, I worked with a lot of different designers, and I probably looked at over 300-400 different logos. Really what the logo represents, so the O is kind of like the drive-through, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you're driving through, that's where the arrow is, and then inside the end you see the coffee cup, right? And then underneath you have our mission of impacting lives one cup at a time. Very simple, beautiful, aesthetic.
Yep.
We went with that kind of magenta pink color to stand out from the competition. I didn't want to go with blue. Dutch Brothers has blue, Starbucks has green,
mm-hmm.
yellow and red, every burger joint has those. So I wanted something that's youthful, bright, vibrant, stands out. When you go to a drive through or a truck, you see the pink, that's the signature Onit color, and you know that's Onit Coffee.
Can you tell us a little bit about the type of ingredients you're using, the equipment, names, or audience like to know details?
Yeah.
And that would be really helpful.
Of course. So the main equipment that we use is all going to be made by La Marzocco. It's all like from Italy, of course.
Okay.
It's like the Ferrari of coffee. So
Can't get any better.
Exactly. We figured if we're going to be the best, we got to definitely use the best. And that's the equipment that we're using. As far as sauces and flavors go, we really go for like the most gourmet we can. A lot of our flavors are vegan, all natural flavors as well. And we try to make our drinks so that it has a sweet texture to it, but you can still taste authenticity of the coffee as well. My goal with each cup is that you can really taste like where it's from. So like our coffee itself, that we get roasted here in Sacramento, actually, it's all roasted local, is directly from the farmers. And we really work heavily with our roaster and directly with the farmers as well. So yeah, my goal is whenever you taste the coffee, it's tasting the hands of the farmers, the baristas, and of course your hands as well. So when we say impacting lives one cup at a time, I truly want you to taste the cup and be able to taste the lives that went into it and all the hard work that went into it as well.
That's awesome. Yeah, you don't hear that very often from really anybody in this type of industry, so pretty cool. With what you know today, is there anything you would have done different? One or two, three things as far as business, growth, you personally?
Absolutely, man. First off, if I would have known COVID-19 was coming, I definitely would have planned to turn the truck into a location right off the top. Right off the top. I would have launched outdoor seating area. I would have listed my services immediately on DoorDash, Grubhub, all the delivery platforms, because those really took off with the pandemic, right?
Interesting.
And I would have announced, you know, curbside pickup a lot earlier. Invested a lot more money into marketing the curbside pickup, into marketing that we're now like a location, and just jumped right into that.
Okay.
That would have saved me a lot of time, a lot of money that I spent on payroll out of pocket when we first started, and we would have grown a lot quicker. So
what else?
Also, when we started, we took about 2 months, man, to brand our cups. So we had blank cups that we were serving. Very dumb move, because
two months,
all the people that were posting our drinks on Instagram, it's a blank cup. And eventually we found like a supplier to make our stickers, and we started branding every single cup, and that really helped take us to the next level. We put a lot more signage outside, started spending a lot more money on marketing, high quality images, and it really took us to the next level.
So don't run a business for 2 months with blank cups.
With blank cups. Very, very dumb idea. So.
The amount of employees that you guys have and the way you run it right now.
Right.
That's kind of contrary to what other food truck owners would tell me and have said in our previous episodes.
Right.
Tell us what that does to your margins. How do you approach it? Why so many employees versus running it more lean? Help us understand
that. So one thing you got to remember with us, our business model is a little bit different in many ways, right? Number one, we're almost essentially now, we've become like a location, right? A lot of food trucks operate with much less, like a lot lower hours than us, right? Some food trucks operate for 4 or 5 hours. We operate from 7 a.m. to 10 p.m.
So
that means that, you know, with all the laws in California, labor laws and whatnot, right? A lot of our employees are part-time basis. So they work like 6 hour shifts, right? So after 6 hours, you have to bring someone else in. And if you work a certain amount of hours a week, then you're owed overtime or you become full-time, right? So to keep people part-time because we're only a truck right now. Also, for me, I look at it as a return on investment for my drive-thru. Why? My drive-thru, I'm going to have to hire upwards of 40 to 50 people because I'm trying to run a 24/7 operation. For example, Dutch Brothers Coffee, they have about 40 to 50 people per kiosk, right? If it's a 24/7 location. So now when I go to hire 30 more people, I have 10, 15 individuals that have been with me for a year or two, right? That have the proper training and experience to train the newbies that enter the company, right? You need to have 10, 15 solid individuals to train the rest of your team.
Right.
So I'm investing this money into them, right? Because I look at it as a long-term investment. If I was just a coffee truck, it wouldn't make much sense, to be honest with you.
Right.
I should probably have maybe 5, 6 people max and call it a day, right? Reason I have 16 is because we're trying to build a franchise.
And I know you've had some team members you wanted to kind of bring in and share a little bit about that. Why don't we do that
now? So with Onit, we're very big on our team, right? We have 16 people that work for the company. And I want to introduce you to Anthony Cesarini, our outreach coordinator, as well as Ruben. He's one of the baristas here.
What's up, guys?
What's going on, brother?
What's going on? Hey, thanks for having me. I just want to say that I appreciate all that this company has done for not only my city and my community, but the work that we plan on doing in the future and the vision that we have and impacting this community and growing and being the most dominant franchise, coffee franchise, in not only Sacramento, but California and in California alone.
This is a big state, so
big state,
good mission.
Absolutely, and then Ruben, I kind of want you to touch on, brother, anything you want to add on?
I'd like to add definitely what attracted me here versus any other coffee spot, because I could easily have gone to a Starbucks, easily gone to Dutch Bros, but here, serving coffee, highest quality as possible, attention to detail, impeccable. You have to get those details right to give the best experience possible to customers. And the fact that we're made up of so many backgrounds, it's incredible. Like myself, I'm Mexican-American, so I know like best sellers right here would be the hot chocolate and the mango. Now this is like best seller, everybody orders it.
Nice.
You know it's the best. So I like definitely coming here to work and knowing I can like touch up a little bit, getting new experience from like all my coworkers, because they're from different backgrounds. Like, oh, you're from like the Philippines, or oh, you're from this place. Like, we're able to talk about our backgrounds and be able to connect more, different experiences you don't get from the average coffee shop going.
Right. A lesson, a tip, mistake you've made in general for our viewers?
To be honest with you, for me with Onit Coffee, it's much more than just a coffee company. It's much more than just making money. I didn't need to, you know, build Onit Coffee to make money. I run successful business with Precision MD, family-owned business.
Right.
And for me, it's more about building that legacy as a Syrian immigrant, impacting lives, serving the city of Sacramento, working with different local nonprofits, you know, and opening up franchising opportunities one day, right? That is my vision for my team, you know? I want to build the most impactful coffee company and franchise in California one day, to give back to my people, the Syrian refugees, to give back to my community in Sacramento, to my city, and to serve people in need, man. That is my number one goal. That is why I got into the coffee industry. And I'd like to lead with love and treat others, you know what I mean, the way they deserve to be treated, man, with love, kindness, and care. That is my goal. That is the mission. And God willing, we will accomplish these goals. And I think within the next 2 to 3 years, you'll hear a lot more on the growth of Onit Coffee. And there will be ups and downs. And like I said, with any business, brother, I embrace failure. I learn from it. I adapt. I continue to push forward. It is the person that puts the most relentless effort into something that succeeds, you know? So for me, I'm willing to put whatever it takes to manifest my vision. And that is the goal with Onit Coffee. And follow up with us, man, in a year, and you'll see a lot of big changes.
We will. So, man, what an incredible way to approach life and business.
Thank you so much, my brother.
Appreciate you, my man.
Thank you so much.
Hope you guys enjoyed this. What an incredible, inspiring story. A new twist on food trucks. If you like this video, make sure you hit that like button. Only takes a few seconds. Subscribe to our channel. And make sure you check out all our other videos that we've done on food trucks.